O labing makagagahom nga amay namon sa langit, mahinuklugon nga laon nga tagtugas ang langit, hangin kalayo, tubig kagduta. Tanda ining imong timawa, gabay ining pag-ampo, magadulot sa amon sang kabuhi nga himaya. Salamat sa mga bugay nga imo ginpaambit sa amon. Salamat sa kabuhi nga ginadulot mo sa amon nga himpit. Salamat sa maayo nga panahon kag ilabinagid sang imo katutom sa amon. Bindisyon ni ang imo katawhan. Bindisyon ni ang ilang mga pal. Inahalad namon ang ining pag-ampo para sa imo kadayawan.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Visayas Islands Visual Arts Exhibition and Conference. And this is our 12th edition for our virtual conference 2. And we started last November with our virtual conference 1, focusing on futures studies of focusing on the family, business and economics, art education, and governance. And today, we continue to have our virtual conference, and our theme, the soon or what now, is in keeping with future studies, which postulates possible, probable, and preferable futures, and the worldviews and myths that underlie them. What now seeks to understand the context and circumstance of the art community in relation to the sectors of the community it coexists with, what is likely to continue, and what could possibly change. Part of the creative initiative is to seek a systematic and pattern-based understanding of the past and the present, promote inclusivity, and determine the likelihood of future events and trends so as to better respond with alternatives towards a much preferred future. The virtual conference started last November and will continue until June of this year. So far we have like 12 Saturdays that we have continued to present our brothers and sisters in the arts and focusing on different topics. And today, we have, I would like to introduce the moderator for today, for our virtual conference. Our virtual conference today focuses on curators converse, what happens. And then our moderator is Dr. Patrick Flores. Is a professor of art studies in the Department of Art Studies at the University of the Philippines, which he chaired from 1997 to 2003, and curator of the Vargas Museum in Manila. He was one of the curators under construction, New Dimensions in Art Asia in 2000 and the Guangzhou Biennale position papers in 2008. He was a visiting fellow at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. in 1999 and an Asian Public Intellectuals Fellow in 2004. Among his publications are Painting History, Revisions in Philippine Colonial Art in 1999, Remarkable Collection, Art History at the National Museum 2006, and the Past Peripheral Curation in Southeast Asia 2009. I will not read all Brani Patrick, but he has done a lot. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Dr. Patrick Flores.
Thank you, Manny, for the introduction. So, Node 3 of this seminar gives us a good opportunity to have a conversation with artists with greater detail on the respective projects for Kalibutan. So this morning we will be in conversation with two artists. First is Leo Abayan, who is from Bohol and now lives and works in Quezon City. He's a professor at the College of Fine Arts in UP Diliman and has also worked in film. And the other artist is Jowar Songkuya, who is by training a seaman, but is also a practicing artist and recently had an exhibition at Altromondo. So we will now begin the conversation. I will toss around three questions for Leo and Jowar. The first question has something to do with materiality, the materiality of art. And by materiality, I mean the range of things that go into the production of the work, from concept to medium, and then to technique and other things besides this. So I'd like to pose this question or these issues to Leo first. So Leo, can you talk about Ray Albano, the artist curator in the 70s, has this interesting phrase, Roots, Basics, Beginnings, which was also an exhibition he curated. So I think this note is about that, no? Roots, Basics, Beginnings. And so I'd like to ask the roots, basics, beginnings of this particular project, Leo.
Next slide, please. Sapa, next slide. Okay. The project, no, as a concept, no, it's really a surrogate world, no, which is in a series of photographs that in a way essay our footprint, the human footprint in the world. The diorama which I created changes through time, and so do the coverage and the visual elements in the photographs. So my work is durational and serial, and intends to capture the changes in the landscape which I've created, which in the actual world are actually indiscernible, and we usually ignore it, no, until things become irreversible. So in a way, the concept, the work, no, is also conceptualized as a kind of a, because in a way it is a narrative, para siyang cautionary tale also. Mm-hmm. And then as for the medium, next slide please. I actually have used diorama and photography Diorama literally means that which is seen, no? From the Greek word di, which means through, and orama meaning sight or something that is seen. No? It was invented by Frenchmen, no? Si Jean-Marie Bouton and Louis Daguerre, who was also the co-inventor of the daguerreotype method in early photography in the 19th century. No? The daguerreotype is that method where the glass, using the principle of camera obscura, and then the glass plate is loaded with nitrate compounds to make it light sensitive, and therefore through a lens it can capture an image where the lens is pointed. So that kind of modality is the same modality that is used also for the dioramas, which was created then. No? Now, the historical link of the diorama to photography, for me, opened up the notion of the role of looking to create an understanding of the world an understanding of the world in the sense that when we picture the world in photography, it is more than just a photochemical or a photoelectronic operation. No? The target of the photograph is to be created first in the mind. No? And how is that done? I think it's by knowing what the target is and anticipating what it can offer. No? Now, in the case of my project, because I was the one who created also the subject or the target, since I made a diorama, by shooting it, I am excavating or revealing another layer of looking. No, the first layer being the looking involved in creating or recreating images or landscapes or terrain in my mind through my experience. And the second looking is also finding opportunities so that I may be able to reveal something or my intuit, no, that was used previously when I created the dioramas. Next slide, please. Now, the idea about dioramas is it's really what hobbyists do, no? And it's not a category in the fine arts, no? This made this project for me more exciting and challenging because the concept demanded a changing landscape that is not usual in dioramas, no? They usually are static and, you know, tableaus, no, for people to look at, no. Since my work is durational, therefore the transition, no, from one photograph to the other and the changes in the diorama itself is very, very crucial. So there has to be some planning involved, no, in the storytelling of the landscape. So therefore, what I have, the set skills that I have in production and set design, in narrative filmmaking, painting, sculpture, and photography, they found a new application, you know, in this project now, which for me is at the same time serious and play. That's why it's enjoyable and it's also challenging, because unlike play, this one has may commitment involved, because I have to show this to people. It becomes it will be presented. Now, to be specific, what I used here, I employed drafting, scaling, modeling, carving, creating, textural and faux finishes. What else did they do? I engineered transitions, no, in the diorama, how it will change, very much like how I would when I do set design, no, when there are changes from scene to scene. And then another thing is I used text, no, written in the form of a verse that is used to complement and boost what Patrick Flores, what you actually, Patrick, told me once, to boost the semiotic charge. So in this case, the semiotic charge of the photographs. No? The tradition of adding verse in landscape imagery is quite common, especially in Chinese landscape painting. So I did not feel odd in doing that. So yeah, I guess that sort of captures, I think, what you're asking for the first question. Can we have slides one after the other? So we can show the work in progress. Yes. So this one, I used SketchUp. Usually, I use SketchUp for projects that are dimensional, that three dimensional. So I use that. Next slide, please. And next slide. So just give you a glimpse. Yeah, and this is my workstation. That's where I make the little trees and all the other little things in the diorama. Next slide. Okay, this is a work in progress. I was able to finish the basic, you know, terrain of the diorama January 2021, second week. I started August. Next slide, please. August 2020. Next slide, please. Yeah. Okay, this is resin. That's not water. That's resin drying out. Next slide, please. There, to give you an example, an idea of the scale. Okay, there. That's my camera pointing on this slide, particular slide. You can see that it's very obvious that there is a layer. There is something underneath this slope. No, so that's one of the techniques I use. No, next slide, please. Okay, this will give you an idea of, you know, what, you know, the scale and the, you know, the camera that I actually used to pick out certain areas in the diorama that I created. The work table that I have actually can be turned 360, so around, no, on its own axis, so I'm able to get to adjust it without necessarily moving my tripod, which, because my studio is not that big, is quite a major operation. I also use backdrops in case some images or some views go off the limits of my diorama. So right now, I'm using a photo, just to be ready, no, photographic backdrops. Now, these backdrops also serve as my plan B. No, and this is very, very filmmaking technique. Now, that if there is no sun, or I cannot, or something wrong happens, I cannot shoot outside, I always have this backdrop on hand. In fact, now that we're talking about atmospherics, no, the air. Maybe Joe R can lend me a painting that I can use as a sky backdrop, because napaka-atmospheric yung trabaho niya. So that could be another possibility. Next slide. Okay, this is an example of the diorama I shot an area, part of the diorama I shot in an actual sky background. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, now just to give you an idea of what I've done so far in the last 3 months. Okay, this is the first photograph in the website where I posted the photos. Next slide. Okay, then these are the next 5 photographs issued weekly. No, the text on the side are the titles, but when you actually read them, no, as one continuous thing, you would it actually reads like a poem, no. So verse, parang verse siya, no. And each passage conforms with the image, but truth to tell, that this poem is also ongoing. So I build the poem and I build the images, and they are reflexive with each other. So sometimes it is the image that creates the verse, and sometimes it is the verse that makes me choose what part of the diorama I shoot. So unlike in the movies where you have a script and then you shoot what the script says, this one doesn't happen like that. Actually, it's a mixture of two techniques of building the work. No, it's also like documentary filmmaking, that where you have the materials with you, and then you shoot it according to a concept and an idea, and the storytelling happens in the editing table. So it is a mixture of both. So those two methods of working, of creating a kind of a narrative, I think I've used in this project. I've also have atmospherics. So atmospherics, you use, you create smoke, you create mist. It's something that we also do in stage as well as in making films. Next slide, please. Okay, and then this is the last, the next 4 images of the landscape, each one focusing on a certain aspect, maybe helped by the text or the verse, which also serve as its title. And then next slide, please. Okay. This is week 11. The verse says, "Igsuon sa pagsulti o pagsabot," translated as sibling to speaking and understanding. And then week 12, next slide, please. You have a closer view of the same scene, ug kasubo and sorrow. So that is the... This is the latest photograph now on the website, which was created specifically for this project. No? So in this particular photograph, compared to the previous one, you have here a shadow of a human being looking at the 3 mounds. No? So I guess this should answer the question, the first question, Patrick.
Thank you, Leo. Maybe later in the discussion we can talk about the migration of the diorama, the photography, and the poetry to the digital sphere, no? Mm-hmm. Which also makes certain demands on you as an artist, especially because the work is durational, no? But we can talk about that particular materiality, no? Later. So the same questions I will ask. The same question I will ask Jowar. So Jowar, can you respond to that?
Thank you for the question, Sir Pat. So For the concept of my project, Atlantico Pacifico Artico, I will be presenting 6 oil paintings that will depict the 3 major oceans of the world. These works are somehow biographical in nature since these are inspired by my sailing life, navigating the world. A project which is concentrated entirely in my personal journey. But I think this is the ideal concept wherein I would be able to share my story, the narrative of the physical world in my own perspective. How this water world became crucial in my personal quest in finding myself through art and water. And at the same time, a discovery of the smallness of the world despite of the grandness of these diverse bodies of water. When I was growing up, maybe during my intermediate years at school, I would spend much of my free time reading books about the oceans, about the world. And I have this cemented perception how large and dangerous and mysterious the oceans are. And I think this formed my early interest for traveling. And there I ended up taking up maritime career over arts degree. And next, 2009, I found myself embarking on my apprenticeship on board a bulk carrier waiting in the Australian port. And then 2010, 11, 12, 13, 14, until 2020, I have sailed to over 50 countries and almost 100 shipping ports and terminals around the world, crossing these major oceans, spending 1,000 nights and days above the water. Yes, the ocean is the loneliest part of the world. I have cried a lot of times while in the middle of the Atlantic storm. Celebrated most of my birthdays and Christmas parties in the Pacific, being chased by the pirates of the Persian Gulf, passing the freezing Arctic, transiting around the Magellan Strait, the most unstable bay of Biscay, to the Africa's Cape of Verde, Mediterranean to the Black Sea, then to the Indian Ocean and back to the Pacific. The ocean is such a big part of my personal story and how this water world made me an artist, how I was able to see something more of the world beyond sailing and working on a job that sustained me and my family as an overseas Philippine worker in a foreign water. In this project, I want to replicate or put into canvas this sense of wonder and greatness of the water, both its beauty and hideousness, how mysterious the oceans are and how it possesses this haunting spirituality that it could push a certain navigator or a sailor into an endless state of contemplation. When a human being is placed in an undesirable place or condition, there's this kind of resistance at first, but sooner or later, this resistance will become acceptance, and this will turn into a sense of comfort, like you get used to it. You are conditioned to be a part of it. One is freed from this enslavement or complexity, and this is what I wanted to present in this project, to show the power of the ocean in shaping or changing a person's aspirations. What I have discovered being in the water for long years, this connection from the soil is so intensely demanding that it will put a man to a test, to search for his own meaning and the world's meaning. Next slide, please. For the medium, I will be using oil on canvas. For years, this is the only medium where I am most comfortable with. Oil paint has this forgiving ability wherein you could play, alter your concept by just adding another layers of paint when the first layer dries up. It is quite an intimidating medium at first, but oil paint can really offer this kind of versatility, especially that I tend to divert most of the time from my paper studies. Most of the time, my drawings on paper, when executed on the canvas, changes. I have this concept, an exact solid placement of objects. And then when I started executing it on the canvas, something really changes. It feels like oil possess this kind of mystery wherein the mind of the artist synchronizes with his hand when then the planned concept on paper is being abandoned. The process plays a big part in the contemplation of a certain concept, and I think only the oil medium could give this kind of generosity or flexibility. The oil paint, as my preferred medium, is almost oceanic also. The paintbrush is like swimming into the ocean of paints and linseed. This wet media is free-flowing like the sea, unrestricted. Next slide, please. For the technique, I am more interested into impressionistic approach, sometimes expressionistic, but I think the water world is best described into these genera. Aside from that, the first painters which I truly admire are impressionists, Mahler Turner, Claude Monet, and also Van Gogh. These are the painters who have produced outstanding works, works that possess an incredible amount of light, spaces, bold lines, muted to convey a feeling of softness and fragility, even in a confrontation of personal and societal conflict. I may have lived inside a ship, a giant steel and metal house of machines and powerful engines. The seclusion inside the ship toughened me or made me almost mechanical inside in my personality, since I am a marine engineer, but the sea influenced me to be impressionistic, to value light, to trust on my senses beyond my eyes, to be carried away by the beauty and the haunting identity of the sea. I am just letting myself be carried away by the tides. Next slide, please. For the studies of the project, I have here this photo of the sketches and rough drawings of the three major oceans to be executed on canvas. I just added the globe to complete the worldly feeling, just like a mini installation in one corner of my studio. Next slide, please. These are the close-up of the studies on paper. It's just basically water and sky, but the only thing that will distinguish one ocean from the rest is its own mood or personality. I want to achieve the movement of a certain distinguishing features of each ocean to form their individual identities. That's all, Sir Patrick.
Thank you, John. So we're now beginning to see a very interesting conversation between Jowar's work and also Leo's work. And maybe just to add that Jowar and Leo also share the art of poetry. Leo is integrating that in the diorama project, and Jowar also writes poetry. So I now move on to the second question, which has something to do with significance. If in the first question we discussed the matter of art, the stuff it consists of, in this part of the session, we talk about why the art matters to you and why does it have to be produced at this time. So largely it is about significance and also, of course, signification in the long term. So Leo, can you respond or maybe we begin with Leo, no? Yeah, with Leo first. Sorry.
Okay. Next slide, please. Ah, si Joar na lang kasi parang siya ang nauna eh.
Okay, sige. Oh, we'll do it.
Si Joar dito, di ba?
Yeah, yeah.
Sige. Sige ako na, sir.
Okay. Okay. Mo, eh. Sige.
Okay, Sir Pat. Next slide, please. Okay. For a beginner artist, it is very important to choose a subject matter that is close to the artist's interest. As a sailor turning into the arts, I think this project of mine is really handy because it's personal and I just have to tap on my sailing experience to produce an output. This project is like a documentary series of my current narrative, and I know I am like on my baby steps at this stage of my artistic journey. Atlantico Pacifico, Artico, offers a glimpse to the world that occupies a big percentage of our world, the Kalibutan. But at the same time, this is not just focused on the physicality or the natural elements that completes the world or the Kalibutan. This is also a tribute to the men and women who have spent years on the water as sailors or modern-day seafarers. Next slide, please. As what I have discussed on the seminar Node 2, the Philippines is noted as one of the world's major suppliers in the maritime field. And in this country, most of the seafarers are from the Visayas. The Visayan people are natural seafarers and explorers in the earliest times. I myself, as a 21st century sailor and an emerging artist, this idea of producing a personal project that is also touching the world or lives of our overseas Filipino workers at sea is both sentimental and significant on my part. Presenting Atlantico, Pacifico, Artico is presenting the lives of our Filipino Visayan men and women who navigated these major seas. It is not solely central to retelling my artistic journey alone, but it is retelling the lives of the modern-day Magellans at sea. This is a project offered for every seaman, for every family at shore, awaiting for their sailors to come home. Next slide, please. These are my seafarer friends, all from Iloilo. They have also crossed the major oceans. These are the brave faces of the modern-day sailors representing the Visayas Islands to the international waters. They share my sentiments. We all share the same narrative, and we are all shaped by the same water which forced us to our most vulnerable sides. The water which pushed us to our limits, beyond our fears and ambition, what binds us to be composed in the alienating, strange territory of the oceans. This project is their story. Every stroke of the brush, from the mixing plate to the surface of the canvas, how the waves of the water is formed by the paint and linseed to illustrate the ocean and the sailor's story, the sea, and the Kalibutan we live in. Next slide, please. The sea is not just for men alone. Now we got a new breed of women who are having their secured places in a field that only favors men. Brave Visayan women, descendants of a seafaring land who went farther to cross the equator. This is also their story. We lived in a time of rapid technological advancement that sometimes there exist significant stories yet we still fail to notice. I think it's high time that the sea should be told in a different language with the use of paints from a sailor's perspective who happens to be an aspiring artist. To be part of Viva Expo 2020-2021 is such a huge opportunity to tell the story of the sea that will set as a tribute to our Visayan seafarers, a celebration of the great world of the Kalibutan before an Ilonggo's eyes. That's it, Sir Patrick.
Thank you, Jowar, for that very important insight. So the same question to you, Leo. Can you respond?
Yeah. I don't know. Do I have slides? Okay. Those are just notes, no? So basically, we find it problematic to ponder or be inspired, no, by aesthetics, theory, or worse, matters concerning art patronage at a time when we are in the world trying to figure out, as I've said in my proposal, no, an exit from its troubles, no, which to me has actually reached life-threatening proportions, no, and I'm not only referring to the pandemic, I'm also referring to the rape of our natural resources, for example, by unbridled mining. I'm also referring to the growing incidence of persecution and fatal violence to silence dissent, expose corruption, and critique the dispensation of power and government services. Now, I could go on and on. with, you know, what is happening. So in a way, that is the context, no, of Viva Now. And I think also parang a setting, no, for me to in a way reflect, no, given the prompt of Viva to make a work, to reflect and scrutinize, not just to think about an artwork, no, but to reflect on my practice, no, what is my response to the world, what is my motivation, what is my position, no, and parang ito yung framework na ginamit ko when I was trying to conceptualize, no, yung the work, no, for Kalibutan. This is not the first idea that came to my mind, no, but this Unsang Dapita photography, yung photographs, no, series, was a response because the first idea was no longer tenable given the lockdown. So there were other options, no, but and the options would have been, how do you say this, would have been easier and more comfortable with me. But for some reason, I chose this. It's really my first time to make a diorama, honestly. And this is figuratively and literally new territory, a new landscape for me. But I chose this. I siguro parang by making a work that is difficult, in a way, I commiserate yung that difficult. I mean, I commiserate with the other people who have also having a difficult time. No, I don't know if that sounds perverse, but I mean, what can I do? No, I'm only an artist. Another thing, I think the important thing about this project is it also enhances my practice, and hopefully I'd be able to inspire other artists to also open up their practices to include other, you know, to be adventurous. This siguro in a way I'm lucky to have a previous experience which I have been able to integrate, no, in what would otherwise be your traditional conventional art practice. So this project actually is a test of that, and it's significant for me. And I'd like to think that when other artists, because I'm also a teacher, an educator, would see it, they it could perhaps inspire and perhaps make them think of other ways of sharing, you know, their voices. Now, this work, no, that I did, was really intended to create some form of awareness, no, that the world is not something that's out there, no. For me, the world is a source of reflection for our humanity and lack thereof. Parang when you talk about self-reflection, you don't really need to look at yourself, the mirror, and be introspective. No, there is a world out there to reflect on. No, because I believe the world is not separate from us. Rather, it is an extension of us, in much the same way as we are its extension. Also, the idea that we are not, I guess, discrete entities, autonomous or free from the world. Parang I hope that this project will make us think that the world is our only home. You know, housekeeping it is one of our major concerns. And how we do it largely determines our well-being, no? If not our survival, no? So it may not be urgent, this concern, but the ice, the glaciers eventually find their way into the rivers, no? And the water finds its way into the sea. So time flies, no? So I think people need to be aware and be able to act, or at least respond now before it's too late, no? So I'd like to think that this project, in whatever outcome, no, it will have when it's finished, would contribute to that conversation.
Thank you, Leo. Yeah. Thank you for that concept of a non-separation between the body of the artist and then the world that also embodies it, no? This, I think, relates well with Jowar's idea of a body of water, which he has navigated, and it's quite a privilege to have done that, no? How many people in the art world have actually done that? But anyway, we move on to the final prompt of this session, which is more speculative, no? Like, how do you envision the work to play out in an exhibition context, no? In the case of Leo, the work is already playing out, no? So it doesn't have to culminate in an exhibition. But we also wonder how he thinks about that possibility, because it's also an option to put up something in Bacolod in June, no? Or is it July? Or somewhere. So maybe we can begin with Leo. Maybe we can continue with your Leo, please.
So when I developed the concept of Unsang Dapita, I already took into account the contingency that the work will not necessarily be viewed in an exhibition setting, no? Fully aware that the pandemic lockdown will continue even after we're done with Viva 2020. You know, the closed space of gallery, as it were, poses a health threat to the public. I believe no artwork should do that. The only threatening thing that an artwork can pose to the public is the changing of minds, attitudes, or preconceptions, the possible transformation that will jolt people from their complacency and comfort. The only downside, you know, of the website scenario, you know, which is what is at hand now in my project, is that it will be subject to the condition of being drowned by other more sensational and sensationalist imagery in the internet, where subtlety and nuance is a death sentence. Because my work fall into this latter category, there must be a way to give it life after it's run in the website, no, without posting a threat to viewers in the context of this pandemic lockdown. So how it will translate eventually is something that I'm thinking about. Maybe I need to suspend this plan or this idea of yung photography, no, and diorama migrating into the virtual, no, sphere realm. I think at a certain point in the duration, when I'm halfway or two-thirds into the project, when I think things will open up. I always trust in that, no? I don't like to predetermine many things. like nature, like the sea, like climate. At least the most enjoyable part, anyway, are those unexpected, you know, things that actually reveal themselves. So I hope that would be done. That would be the road that this project will take eventually.
Yeah, thank you, Leo. I think the internet is the fourth ocean, no?
Pwede. Okay. Yeah.
Jowar, can you respond to that? Can you speculate on what you think will happen in Bacolod in relation to your project? Yeah.
I think, just like with Sir Leo, I think it's high time we utilize the use of social media. It is a very powerful tool to reach more people in a faster way without demanding people to leave their houses for a gallery experience. The art world is really shaken by the pandemic. So almost everyone resorted to digital or virtual experience. And I think it's really effective to invest on social media. I have my Instagram page, which I properly curated, and I set up my page, an artist page, for a wider exposure as well. Art should be distributed and should be exposed with an effort. The social media is somehow toxic with all these issues around and toxicity, but this is the only way to heal us all, to restore all this brokenness that's happening around us. The original plan of this project is focused on the physical setup, but I think I must find a way to present the progress of the project in a more virtual setting before it ends in the gallery space this June or July. I might also create videos as well as the project progresses so that people will have an in-depth and closer interaction of the project. The ocean, Atlantico, Pacifico, Artico, at everyone's fingertips. That's it, Sir Pat.
Yeah, thank you. And we are also planning to release the archive of, some parts of the archive of Jowar, including his letter, his notes, no? His notes, his photography, his video, and his sketches. I was also reminded by a curator who told me that we should change the word globalization into oceanography, because it is oceanography that can explain better what is happening in the world today. So thank you both Jowar and Leo for those insights. I can now take some questions from the floor. The first question is for Leo, and it's both practical and conceptual now. So for the practical part, the question, Leo, is what are the materials used in making the trees and grass in the diorama, the trees and the grass? Now, so that's the more, you know, practical question. And then that is from June Sabile of Calbayog City, Samar. And then the next question is from the famous Dayang Iraula, whose question is, have you considered, Leo, looking at cityscapes instead of cityscapes as a series, as part of the series, maybe the next series of this project? This question is coming from Curiosity of Distance in relation to the idea of surrogacy or surrogateness. Where or how will our looking be directed when the surrogate world is closer to where we physically are? No? I mean, Leo, you live in Quezon City, right? In near Morato. So, mm-hmm. So have you considered the cityscape as the material?
Okay. Yeah. So, to the first question, the trees and the grass. The trees are actually the branches, no? There are two kinds of trees. Yung meron akong trees na pampakapal, no, just to create this crown of trees that I ordered through Shopee, no. But the trees, the camera sees, no, the frontmost trees are actually made in my workstation. I use wire, no, copper wire. You bunch them all together and then you twist it and then you subdivide it as you go along to be able to make branches. Now, there is available parang foliage material in art stores in Yovir and in that store near UST, used by people who make miniatures for creating architectural models. So you flecked it there, and then you create the leaves of the trees, no? And then there are certain techniques, and many of the techniques are available online on YouTube on how to make them very, very realistic, no? You have to be careful though, in terms of scale. You have to be very conscious of the scale. So the choice of the wire is also very important. Depends on how big the trees will be. Now, for the grass, there is what we call synthetic grass. No, it can be bought online, and there is an equipment, a flocker, they call it. It's flocker that uses static electricity. No, you place the surface, you put adhesive on the surface, and then you get the negative charge there, and then when the positive charge is turned on, the small grasses will fall on the adhesive, but because it is static electricity, it will stand on its end, diba? Very much like your hair, no? When you hold on something that is static, tatayo yung ano mo, yung buhok mo. So that's the same principle for creating the grass, no? Now, again, the painter's eye comes in, how to make the grass more more realistic looking, if you want to achieve that kind of a naturalism. So therefore, that's where your research come in. You research on botany, on grasses and how they grow, what grasses grow together well. You look at nature photography and see that, oh no, it's not one singular green carpet of grass, but it's an assortment of different textures. So in this process of making a diorama, para kang nag-aaral ng ano rin, nag-aaral ka ng botany, nag-aaral ka, well, in my case also, parang what are the geological strata that I need to, you know, to address, no, because my diorama is changing. So practically, parang ganun yon. So if this, kung sino man ito, you can always get in touch with me, and I'll give you the links of where you can actually buy these materials, because it would be nice if many artists also make this kind of work. Yung little things na parang kasing tingin ko ang diorama para siyang bonsai. No, it's a world in the miniature. It's the practice is very Chinese. Yung you try to put in the smallest of dimensions an entire world, no? Whether it is carving on jade or whether it is making small trees in bonsai, or whether we're making aquariums or terrariums, no? Kasama natin yan sa kultura natin.
So Leo, just before you go to the next question, just a quick follow-up or a related question from Gershon Distora. If materials po ay out of stock, do you have any DIY to make the parts po, like grass?
Ah, yung grass? Oo, meron. Kumuha kayo ng abaka, yung abaka rope, no? Abaka rope, and then you disentangle it so that it will be down to its simple strands, and then you cut it. No, you cut it and then ilagay mo siya sa dye to make it green. You make sure that the dyes are different of different tonalities of green. And then once they're dried together, no, i-ano mo siya, iwa-hiwala yun. Yun, pwedeng gawing grass yun. Or yung shavings ng felt or any paper, pwede rin yun. Basta importante, very, very fine siya. Yun. Mm-hmm. And then you subject them to dyes. Wag paint, wag yung art pigments because dumidikit yung ano nila, yung dumidikit yung solvents nila. So they adhere to each other. I've tried that, no? It's a failure, no? It's really best to use yung dye, yung tina. Bibili ka ng tina sa ano, sa palengke, no? The green, different kinds of green. Kasi with water, yun, hindi siya magdidikit, no? Once it dries, no? So it goes back into, and then again, be very careful about the scale. Depending kung ano yung scale ng ano mo, ng diorama mo, syempre ipo-proportion mo rin yung scale, yung length ng leaves of grass. Doon. Okay. So
dapat mag-workshop na si Leo on the diorama.
Hindi pa. I don't think kaya ko pang mag, siguro in my fifth diorama kaya ko na mag-workshop. But they're wonderful how-tos in the YouTube, and they're pretty much masters in themselves. In fact, I learned lately that yung dioramas, that many people make dioramas because when games, yung games na mga war games online and everything, not all of them are computer generated. Kasi it takes so much time to computer generate everything. Sometimes the terrain, no, for these games are actually dioramas, and then they scan it and then transpose it online. And then it's the graphic artist who will add buildings and stuff like that. But the terrain itself are made by hobbyists, no, ng the diorama. So that's the way they do. That's one way of them to earn money, to buy materials, to make their own dream projects. So yon. So yung sustainability also of the practice is also there.
Yeah. So Leo, so quickly now to the second question about,
okay,
why not the city?
Yung sa city, maybe I would eventually do that. The first one, simply because it was really an offshoot of yung nostalgia ba, because you're in quarantine, you're in lockdown, and me being growing up in the province, probinsyano talaga ako, parang I miss going to the province, you know, open air, looking at sceneries and different places in Bohol. So mas my being a country person is the one that really came to the forefront in trying to make this miniature, this scape, no, landscape diorama. I probably will go into the city, but I'd be very, very careful because there is a tendency for dioramas like that to look like architectural scale models. No, mm-hmm. The last thing that I'd like to communicate is to strengthen the urbanization by creating a diorama na, ay, maganda pala pag may ganyan. I refuse it. Hindi ganda. Ano may ganon? There is a temptation for that to beautify. Yes, di ba? Yeah, to beautify urbanization. Sa akin, it's only half. Kalahati lang. Depende kung anong klaseng urban development. Yun daya.
It related, Leo, to gentrification. Huh?
Yes, also at this, yeah, yung in the more cultural side, yung pag-gentrify. So, I probably will do that, but I'll be very, I don't know yet. Pero But this, this landscape that I'm creating, in fact, spoiler alert ito, kasi there are 36 views, diba? Mm-hmm. At a certain point, you will see a house being built in the landscape. So I've already planned for that. Na may house na magtatayo doon, and then may roads na lalabas dyan, magkakaroon ng bridge, and there will be things that will emerge, very much like what happens to the world, no? Yung parang siguro a model would be Boracay. Even Boracay in the 80s and the 90s, oh, that was really paradise. I mean, truly ganon, no? And then of course, with the inclusion of, you know, tourism and the greed for money and all of this, you'd see how landscape is transformed. And then what is very pitiful is the ones that closely resemble the pristine conditions of a certain place are reserved for those who can afford, for the very rich. No, that's why even sa Boracay, there is a zoning, di ba? Yung maganda no, nasa pangmayaman na area. No? And then of course, the dregs is in section 3. No? So parang ganon. I try not to use that as a kind of a model. Also because it's sometimes happening also in Panglao, in Bohol. So I'm looking at this this approach very cautiously, no, not to repeat, in fact, no. So parang I should remember, no, my project is a cautionary tale.
Yeah, that's
so
true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you, Leo. And there's a question for Jowar. Jowar, the question has something to do with the limitations set by the pandemic, how you are dealing with those limitations, and maybe to face it another angle of that question is because you're a sailor and you're used to the openness of the sea, and as an artist you are confined to the canvas, so also has something to do with limitation. Do you think that this oil on canvas framework imposes certain limits as well? Because your previous world, even your current world as a sailor, is quite encompassing, expansive, and quite very open. Although you've said that Impressionism has given you that language, no? To, you know, access the atmosphere, and there is this relationship between oil and the sea. But yeah, maybe you can speak to this concept of limitation imposed by the first, the pandemic, and second by oil on canvas. Yeah. Joel.
Thank you for the question. As I see myself, I had spent almost a decade working on the water. And I must admit it to myself, there's this kind of shifting on how I view the sea if I'm inside the ship, and how I see it if I'm already at home or I'm already in the soil. It's kind of, how do I say this? You know, when you get used to this environment, like you are in the water for, let's say, 8 to 9 months at sea, like it became your habitat, there's really a change in your personality. Like, should I expose myself here? I mean, it feels like even if I'm in the city, or if I'm walking on the street, or even if I am in the crowd, I still feel this kind of strange isolation. I mean, yeah, artists are basically isolated and they have this kind of peculiarity, but the sailing experience had really made me some kind of, I mean, there's pandemic, there's this pressure of the outside world, but I felt like I am safe. I have this kind of safe refuge inside the studio. Like, there's still this kind of, you know, I became a sea myself. Like, the ocean, like when we say Atlantic or Pacific or Arctic, I have this solid image that just flow immediately. Like, when I hear the word Atlantic, I am very, very familiar. Like, it became my parents. Like, it became a brother or a lover already. The sea has become a part of me. And sometimes even if I am sleeping, I still have these times where I felt like I'm still in the water. Like, I could still feel the vibration of the ship. And also, as an artist, I have developed my artistry inside the cabin. Like, it's just in the later years where I tend to paint in an open air in the railings of the ship. For the first few years, I have spent most of my artistic, my painting sessions inside the cabin. So the cabin is a secluded, it's like a box, or you just have a very, very small 18 by 24 porthole. And there you created this kind of expansion I just felt that I became a sea myself. And it's very, very strong that maybe that's it, Sir Patrick.
Thank you, Jowar, for that poignant but also very urgent insight. We don't have much time. And maybe to close, I have a question can be answered by both of you. This is from Jason. Now, so, and this is for Jowar specifically, but I think Leo, you can also respond. So, knowing that you chose art over your continuing career as a seaman, this is specific for Jowar. What can you say to artists who are scared to pursue art as their dream? But I think, Leo, because you're a teacher, you can also respond to that. So I think this question is for both of you. Maybe to repeat, knowing that you chose art over continuing your career as a seaman, what can you say to artists who are scared to pursue art as their dream?
Even when I started sailing in my first year, 2009-2010, I already had a very clear picture of what I wanted to be. I really want to make art, and you know, I really love creating. It's just circumstances made me be patient. I mean, it took me more than a decade of working at sea because I don't have any choice but to follow that. I'm aiming to be in that kind of job. But I think it doesn't matter if you are in a different profession or background. Art will just call you. I mean, it will really call you. It's like a vocation. It's like being a priest. I mean, there are bad guys who ended up becoming a priest themselves because it just happened that life made them see the world in a different perspective. They have this kind of mission to fulfill. And in my case, to be honest, I wanted to become an artist, but I don't have a solid or strong reason when will I do it. It just happened that last year, I was faced with a very intense confrontation I nearly died while my ship is trading from Africa to Spain. So February 2020, I've been suffering for appendicitis. And there's, of course, it's in the middle of the sea and it's very far from the land. And I just told myself that if I will be given the chance to go home, I will do what I have to do. And I will pursue what's driving me to live. And I think that incident is what I have been waiting for. So I went home in March, still in the wheelchair after my operation in Spain. And then lockdown happened. And then I told myself, what do I have to do? I have to
make something. I want to become an artist. I have to equip myself. And I gathered my portfolio. I applied to UP Fine Arts while on my recovery. I think the art will make a way for you to find it as long as you are, you know, passionate, driven, you devote your life into it. It's just like marriage. I mean, people my age are raising their babies, have their cars, have their third child. And for me, I'm a 30-year-old man starting my life as an artist. I think I'm married to art already. It just happened.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jowar, for making the link between art and appendicitis. So, Leo, can you respond to that question?
Okay, sa akin, how do you, the question is about, ano yung Patrick, para lang ma-clear yung question.
Artists who are scared to pursue their...
The artists are scared to, ano, there is actually a book, it's called Art and Fear. I-google nyo yan. Magandang, it's a small book, but it's a good read. It's quite thin. Yung fear of pursuing art, that comes from the fact that you haven't answered a crucial question. What do you want in art? I think that's important. What do you want in art? You are an artist, you think you have some form of talent, you are able to express yourself in the visual idiom. Okay, but what do you want in art? That's very important. You have to address that, because if you're able to, at least, and not that you can answer it sufficiently, but if you have some good grasp of what you need in art, what you want in art, then I guess half of the fear is gone. Because fear is always good para sa akin, no? Even the uncertainty is always good for me, at least as far as art is concerned. Now, I think it's also a practical question, because, unless you were born from a well-to-do background, you have to pay bills. I mean, there are certain practical things that you need to do to be able to just, you know, survive, especially in our context. Having a day job and making art are not conflicting activities, no? My example is ayokong gamitin yung the usual example of artists who had day jobs and then, you know, who were very successful in their work. I don't want to go there. Maybe I'll go to literature. Anton Chekhov, one of the greatest writers, playwrights ever, no? Who ushered in modernity in writing plays, was a doctor. He was a medical doctor. No? But he also wrote small comedic, what they call this, sketches that prod him to write even better. He read Shakespeare, he read the classics, but on his activity as a doctor by which he lived on, and then his writing, napagsabay niya yon. No? So I guess in the visual art, you want to paint, go ahead, no? Paint, no? But and if you need to survive while your practice could not sustain you yet, then have a day job. It's okay. Swerte ako, I have my day job is really 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 connected to my art practice. But I have to tell you, when I was younger, before, no, I finished actually economics. I worked for Meralco and PNB before. It was a corporate job. Totoo yun, kagaya na sinabi ni Jor, there will become a point when life would tell you, okay, this is where the road will fork. you have to choose what path. No?
Was that appendicitis too, Leo? Hindi naman.
No. It was not appendicitis. It was EDSA. It was EDSA. That was the time that I should be holding on to something more secure. But lo and behold, no, I gave up corporate life, at least the illusion of security in corporate life, and started going into filmmaking. The choices sometimes don't have to be rational. Sometimes you have to respond to what the heart tells you.
Yeah, that's nice. I'm under extreme pressure to close this session, but maybe just to share what P.V. Roldan has placed in the chat box. And I quote him, more established artists, more than the artists who were formally schooled, Jowar should find himself in a more ideal place to produce art, not pressured by the market, style, public expectations, peer pressure, financial problems, and the like. And having developed his own methodology, intellectual process, and personal advocacies for the ocean, he has become a model of an autodidact, a well-grounded person, despite spending 10 months out in the sea that other emerging artists emulate. And I think in relation to these words of wisdom from PV, who has seen a lot, for Jowar, no? Very practical question. If someone tries to commission you a painting that is different in style, na nakasanayan mo, I am quoting Gerson Distora, ano ba dapat gagawin? Ang first move, decline or accept the commission? Maybe we can end with that very bread and butter question. Yeah. Did you get that, Jowar?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
What is your
instinct? Yeah.
Pera din po yun, sir. I mean, it's a commission job. This is Philippines. I mean, there's a pandemic, and yes, I will accept that. Kahit iba pa yung style noon or subject, pera yun, it's clean money, and you put effort into it. But in a serious note, I understand that. I mean, in my own perspective, as I enter this complicated art world, medyo nagkakaroon talaga ng ano, ng parang nababox yung artist na you have to have a certain style bago para makilala ka. You have to stick with a certain kind of branding. In my case, it just happened na ngayon sobrang lapit ng dagat sa story ko, and I am learning the ways of the art world. I am studying now at UP. I'm taking theory. I know it will change, and that's the beauty of art making. You are a free man. You are free to choose your subject regardless of the demand of the market or whatever. If you are good, if your art speaks to the society, if it touches the heart of other people, you don't have to be scared if you will live or you will be able to eat or survive. Just do it. Anggapin ang komisyon.
Okay. So yeah, maybe that's the fifth ocean, the art world. At maraming sharks dyan. So anyway, we bring this session to a close. Thank you, Leo, and thank you, Jowar, for making the time and sharing your insight. I'm sure the audience appreciates that. And now I turn the screen over to Panay Possibilities, that will be presided over by the Island Coordinator of CAPIS, Marika Constantino. So over to you, Marika.
Thank you, Patrick. To continue this informative morning, we welcome you to the second part of today's session, Panay possibilities, video festivals as a means to interconnect. With the advent of the pandemic, immense changes have affected all of us. Artists and cultural workers were not spared nor cushioned from the adverse effects, be it our livelihood, well-being, practice, mental health, physical existence, or creative inspiration. After a little over a year, we are still going through a seemingly perennial roller coaster ride of uncertainty. We hope, hopefully, a big portion of our society can be vaccinated soon in order for the country to attain a herd immunity to confront the challenges of rebuilding and restructuring. It is from the idea of recalibration that we thought of today's subject matter. Given that we are in transition between the current scenario and the perceived better normal, we can use this moment to reflect and chronicle and make use of our intuitive nature with the purpose of coming up with possible collective works. What we offer is a proposition, an idea to ponder upon, while we are still far from the usual face-to-face scenario, we can look at videos and moving images as a means to come together, to celebrate, to exhibit. Most especially because majority of the population have smartphones, the availability of apps, and the accessibility of information, this is quite doable. The compendium of works can be reframed as festivals that act as alternative platforms to compile our accounts, experiences, and contemplations. Our lens as artists and cultural workers, coupled with our creative eye, can develop the use of this medium, expand on existing proficiencies, and amplify the connections within our communities. Festival may seem like a big word. However, it is simply defined as a periodic celebration or program of events. It does not have to be an immense undertaking. As mentioned, what we wish to open up for discussion today is the idea of organizing a festival as a modest project that any barangay, municipality, locality, province, or community can execute. Any artist or cultural worker can, in fact, initiate this. We can all come together to make this happen. We have invited Mr. Joe Andrew Torlao to help us navigate through the technical requirements, steps, framework, structures, and basic know-how to make this concept possible and feasible for us. We now have Sheila Molato, Iloilo's Island Coordinator, to introduce our featured guest so that we can get to know him better. Sheila?
Thank you, Marika, for the introduction. So I will now read our guest's bio. Joe Andrew Torlao is a graduate of Bachelor of Arts in Communication and Media Studies from the University of the Philippines Visayas, a cultural worker and currently a project development officer and unit manager of the International Distribution Unit at the Film Development Council of the Philippines. He has produced short films and managed a full-length film production and has staged, developed, and helped out in organizing various film festivals, exhibits, and film retrospectives locally and abroad in the past 5 years. He has been selected and was part of a various international training programs for film exhibition, programming, curation, and film festival development. He also served as marketing manager, researcher, and assistant to the curator for the VivaXCon organization in the Iloilo that staged the 2016 VivaXCon. I will give you now the virtual floor to our featured guest, Mr. Joe Andrew Torlao.
Hello, good morning. Mayong aga sa tanan. I can't see everyone, but I'd like to say hi to the people, sa audiences, and to our fans, the Viva fans in YouTube. Ayun. So, okay, so I'll start na. So yun nga, as mentioned by Marika, let's demystify the film festival, no? Something that's maybe scary for most of us, even the concept of film and the engagement in film or filmmaking. So I just titled this presentation as Community Film Festival with a Project Management Point of View. Next slide, please. So yeah, so I'm a filmmaker. I'm not an expert on video art or film art or experimental art. I have limited resources as well and limited exposure. But I'd like to share my experiences lang and how I think film festivals and any other project can be viewed as a project, and how can we use the lens of project management in understanding this one. So yes, I program films as well for our embassies abroad and then for local institutions here in the Philippines. This presentation is not fully research-based, like a thesis type. I'll have examples, but I won't have a video example since naglalag siya. But I ask the organizers to send to you some links na gagawin ko ring samples. Maybe you can watch it later. So yun, so my experience involved me in different projects. I helped out in Viva, and yun, kinakabahan ako kasi dito si Sir Patrick, who I assisted in Viva 2016, and also Miss Dayang Iraola, who gave us also a lecture and on community art curation. And I thank both people for inspiring me to be a cultural worker then in my own right. Next. Ayun. So this is Bantayan Film Festival of Gimbal, Iloilo. So I took this photo in April 2017 when I'm transitioning to Manila for a position in the head office of FDCP. And I was shocked and I was thrilled, excited, pero takot din. Because like most of us, I am also mystified by the concept of film festival and how complicated it may be to gather like thousands of people for a night or in a single location. So Bantayan is 17 years already, the film festival. And they have, for this year, they have, for 2017, they have 6,000 people for a night in their plaza. So this is what's familiar to us, big crowded and Labrador's film festival. It doesn't have to be that way all the time. Next, please. So this will be my thesis point for the presentation. Like with something that's familiar to most of us, like visual art exhibit or community art, film festival is also a project. And I'd like to invite everyone to view this with a project management point of view. I prepared up the following slide, an outline for the presentation. And we'll try to simplify the film festival and demystify it. Next, please. So we'll follow this outline. So 4 parts lang siya. I'll try to keep it short as possible. And let me know if I speak fast. Okay, so first will be film festivals. Ano ba yung film festivals? Bakit siya komplikado? But I will not go into the complex film festivals like of big international film festivals, the big festivals in the Philippines, etc. Let's just do like a community festival point of view. But forgive me if my example sometimes would include yung mga complicated na examples and what we did before or ano yung experience ko before. And then mag-touch lang tayo konti on film and video. Then for project management, it's like a review, and the whole presentation actually is just a review of the basic things that we know, because if you organize a birthday party or a kasal or binyag, if you facilitate those things, you're actually doing a project. And how do we dissect a festival or anything, any project with a project management point of view? Then we go to film festival as a project. So we understand the scope, the resources needed for a film festival, and then we elaborate more on the parts of a film festival that you can do and the basic know-how na pwede nyo ring take home. So yun, I will not define film festivals na grabe, but the examples and the structure and understanding it fully sa mga next na slides will define it also. Next. So film festivals and then video as medium and why we explore this medium. Next. Okay, so film festival, sabi ni Lauren Macriel, on a very basic level, is usually a multi-day event during which a selection of films is played for audiences. So yun lang, yung pinaka-basic lang. Pero yung ibang festivals, we are familiar with, are very broad. Sometimes they're very specific, like there's a women film festival for women directors only, there's a documentary film festival, there's an art house film festival, there's an alternative film festival, experimental film festival. So iba-iba siya, but on a very basic note for everyone, so it's just a selection of films played for a specific audience rin with a specific time frame. Next. So an example, so this is Alam Mindanao Asian Film Festival in General Santos City. This is November 2017 when I was still the regional festival development coordinator of the agency. So this is their programming of films with poetry or poetry in films as well. And they screened it in a coffee shop, so cafe siya. And then they have poetry readings, they have discussions as well after the film was screened. So parang cute hangout place siya. And it's not the usual film festival that we have, like sinehan lang siya tapos nanonood lang kayo and then have the talk back with the filmmakers after. Next, please. And this is NABI Film X in Abuntoran, Davao de Oro, or Compostela Valley in September 2019. So similar to Gimbal, outdoor screening siya sa plaza nila. But this festival, they were given a chance to screen films rin using an inflatable screen. So meron sila, doon nila pinoproject yung pelikula nila. So there are 15 or 16 years old na rin. And similar to Gimbal, it also bore fruit to local filmmakers who are making films rin, like high school students, iba college students, na similar din to other filmmakers na hindi naman full-time filmmakers but would want to make films. And this one specifically is tourism-sponsored, yung NABI FilmX. So it's sponsored by their tourism council kasi yun nga, they wanted to promote NABI Nabunturan for the parang center for film or whatever in Compostela Valley. Next, please. Ayan. So, daanan lang natin konti. Yung film, video, moving images, ano ba siya, and bakit siya exciting then for others. Next. So, very basic definition lang din. Na before, it was black and white really, na parang film siya, if may narrative siya, then auteur film siya kahit may narrative, but the filmmaker or the director would put more focus on the art rather than the story. And then video art siya pag manipulation lang siya of the video as a medium. But this black and white, actually, ang dami niya ng gray areas ngayon. Because before film, dapat i-screen mo siya sa black box na tinatawag nila. So it's like the cinemas where, yun nga, itim siya, black box siya, tapos may screen sa harap mo, nakaupo lahat ng audiences. And then video art usually in exhibits or in museums or in galleries, then where it is projected becomes an installation or a sculpture in that exhibit. And unlike the black box, in a white cube, as they call it, you can move freely around it. You can even touch it, unlike sa film na may distance ka and all. Pero ang dami niya na rin gray areas, ang dami na rin mga pagkakataong hindi siya nasusunod kasi nga hindi naman talaga siya ganun lang dapat, especially during the digital era na ang dami na rin gumagawa. And yun nga, the definition na rin of moving images, na anything na may video component na gumagalaw is a moving image, etc. So elusive siya for others. It's strange kasi alam lang natin ay gagawa ka ng pelikula, kailangan ng audio, kailangan ng cinematographer, etc. But we feel to recognize as well that we can film or we can just take videos with our phone and that can be an art itself, that can be film itself. So yun, kahit yung mga cat videos actually ay na-exhibit na rin and napoprogram ngayon sa ibang film festivals abroad. So it, because of the digital era, naging mas malapit siya sa atin and mas naging madali rin yung paggawa ng film and video art. Next, please. Next slide, please. Hello. Next, please. Hello. Hello. Next slide, please. Oh, I think we lost the host. Sorry for that. I'll try if I can share.
Maybe you can just share your screen.
Yeah. I'll try. Bri, as you're the host now, can you allow me to share screen?
Oh, please.
Sorry for this technical issue, but because there are scheduled power interruptions in the hall, so that may be the reason.
Okay, can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, yes. Sorry about this. Okay, so they say film as a medium can reverberate amongst audience members. And it's on a personal level. Sabi nga sa Human Rights Film Festival setting up, it could change or influence individual perception or opinion then. And unlike other forms of art, they say it's more relatable because you can relate sa character, sa setting nila, and kung sino sila. And now, it's really common rin. And, it's tricky because others would still believe that it's really hard or it's really expensive to do it because they thought that their video from phone won't bring them anywhere. But you can actually do vlogs or diary film. Like Idlat Tahimik is a documentary filmmaker and an artist and a filmmaker. And his filmmaking style is like a diary film. Like may footage ng journey, etc. Random footages of birds, of trees can bring you somewhere else. It can also be a short documentation of your artistic process or your experiences rin, or it could be interviews with artists or with local communities. It can be like a journalistic approach of documenting like the community pantries around you, what's happening around you. It can be home movies, like graduation ng anak mo or birthday, and you just film it. Or you can see if your home movies are archived as well, or if you have like VHS tapes in your house and you can maybe digitize it, then you can manipulate it, and that can be your medium. This is a Mi 10T Pro, and last year I produced 5 short films with this camera. So phone cameras are accessible now. It can shoot in 4K and 8K, but even yung mga 1K or 2K na phone cameras, when you edit it in your laptop or any editing device, it's actually very clear already, and hindi na siya nagpipixelate unlike the former cameras. So this is an example of a work. Video art by a prolific filmmaker and artist from Visayas, Sir Manny Montilibano. This is part of the Venice Biennale and the Philippine Pavilion created by Sir Patrick Flores Ren in 2015. So this is very relevant. If you want to screen this or, you know, in these times where we have to talk about the maritime conflict, etc. This is still from Himorasak ni Pang Solaje. So this film talks about Yolanda. I have a link of his other work then in the link, in the maybe the file that the organizers can send you. This is a still from ABCD by Rox Lee. So Rox Lee is a comic strip artist and an animator as well. And he's famous in the Philippine underground cinema. This is an exhibit from Nick Diocampo's Hidden Cinema Exhibit. So his thesis is actually, other than the famous Hollywood or mainstream star cinema or whatever films in the Philippines, we have that cinema that's like a rhizome. Na hindi rin siya kita talaga ano, and it branches out to different types. Like you have an animation, you have documentary, etc. So this is a sample of what you can do, like film as activism. So Burmese filmmakers would make films about their situation, not even siguro mga before pa mga even before Aung San Suu Kyi or during the height of Aung San Suu Kyi's redemption of democracy. And then there's also Chinese filmmakers who would counter surveillance, the officers who are surveying them in China. So this can be samples of what you can do as well, like just anything around your community. You could tell a story with your phone camera or with a film. So for project management, this is just a quick review. So a project is a piece of work that is designed to bring about an agreed upon beneficial change with fixed time frame using specific resources or specified resources. So it's a temporary one-time coordinated undertaking. It doesn't have to be big. It doesn't have to be long-term. You can decide if it's just a week or a month or a year. So it is defined by its scope or how complex, how simple, how near or how far the project is, the cost, how much expenses are you willing to give, and the resources rin, and the time, how long it will run. But you should also consider the time of preparation for this project or the time that you need to invest rin before and after the project, and the quality, which gives the context to the project, but dependent on the other three, because similar to artworks, if you don't have much time and if you don't have a lot to spend on, the quality is also sacrificed. But there are other projects where you can ask for unlimited resources or you can have more time when quality is king and you can just dictate whatever. Sorry, is there a chat from the panelists? I can open the chat. Okay, sorry. Can you still see my screen? Hello?
Yes, you can still see your screen.
Okay, sorry about that. Okay, so the six phases of a project. So first is the initiation or the ideation, or it's where you identify the problem to be solved or the thing to be created, an opportunity to be exploited or to be answered to, a definition. It's where you refine your ideas and understand what you want to do, when and how. The planning would answer most of the how in deciding the detail, how to achieve the objectives, the time scale, resources, etc. Then the control is when monitoring enters and how you control the resources, how you control everything, how you adjust the plan, if you need to change it. And then implementation, it's passing what you have created over to those who will be using it. So sometimes it will be your supplier for the tents, and then they have to implement it for the catering, etc. And then the review or evaluation is when you assess the outcome and looking back to see if you also have a lot of things to improve on the next project. In a project also, you have to consider the risk or the challenges that are present. And then the resources available, even before starting, because sometimes for example, you have volunteers, like a set of students that can be human resources. You have this venue or a theater that you own that can be additional resources. And you must maximize whatever you have already. So in project management, similar to, that's what we also put king in film programming or curation. Like context defines everything. So we say that programming is contextualization. So it's the why or the idea, and it will dictate everything, that we can sacrifice this much time because this is the context. We can achieve this if we, you know, if we reduce the resources to this much only, etc. Then if we look at film festival as a project, this is how it would look like. The scope, like ano yung focus ng festival na to? What are the number and types of films that will be featured? Will it be like documentary films, diary films of artists? Will it be like a survey of the geography of the artists that are present? Pwede bang mahabang pelikula or dapat 2 minutes, 5 minutes per artist lang? Will it be nationwide or Iloilo lang or Visayas lang? The cost, will it be paid? May sponsors ba to? How much are we willing to spend? Because it will also define rin, it will work with your scope if you need another platform or you're paying for a website, etc. For the time, then you just specify like the festival date, the preparation, when you are expecting people to submit their works, ano pa ba yung festival events mo, like pre-festival and post-festival events. The programming context would define the quality, or and then you also decide if there will only be screenings or side events or conferences, same as the, what we're doing right now. Will it be more on the industry or market side? Because other festivals are industry platforms, actually. Like if you're featured in Cannes, for sure you will be distributed in France, similar to exhibits or to artists, that if you're picked up by this gallery, be sure to have more time creating your art because a lot of people will be buying your artwork. For the risk and resources, piracy issues, especially now that it's online, and then who's handling the films, the censorship issue as well, when because in the Philippines, we have institutions that are not very friendly with our artists and with the art that they're putting out there. Does this disturb or provoke institutions? And then the resources. So most of the time it's beyond cash. It's the artists, it's the contribution of individuals who are willing to volunteer or to give their time to you. So these are also your resources. So the structure, for the structure and framework, so the minimum requirement actually for staging your festival is to specify a date. When is it happening? And to identify where it's happening, like the venue. And then the selection, what are you offering? Are these 3D films? Are these community documentaries? Are these surveys of the landscape, etc.? Then you're good to go. I mean, if you have this, you can have like that gathering of people. That's already a festival. Or if you don't want to call it a festival, that can be a celebration event or another industry event. For a festival structure, you must identify who's in charge of what. How does the organizational chart or your organigram look like? Who do people go to when they need specific stuff? And also, who would you go to if you need something? It will also define if the structure would be also defined by the context. If it's more of industry, then maybe the income generating director would be more at top, or would it be the creative director? For the framework, it's actually, there's no cookie cutter template for everything, actually. So how do you see your festival would define how you will function as an organization. So what will be your guiding principles? What will be your values? And then how will you connect to the audience is also part of the framework. And that differs from one event or one festival from another. Then the films, what films will be part of the selection? Are we focusing on an issue? Are we introducing a different region, etc.? So the picture that you can see there in a small circle is actually my friend from Malaysia who did the programming of Malaysian films in Nabuntoran. And it's the first time that the students would watch short films, creative short films from Malaysia, and we brought it to them. So that would also define it. For programming, how are you presenting the films? In what order, during what time, and where are you presenting it? Do you have other programs aside from film? Like, do you have like talkbacks? Do you have like seminars or master classes? This photo is like a dance presentation that reacts to the film that's being shown in Salamindanao. So they screened the film in a theater studio, and then there's dance presentation alongside it. For the audience, who are they? And what, so you must also understand what they need and what they like. They say that a festival without an audience is nothing. So you should, if the audience can't come, like during the pandemic, you should bring the festival to the audience. That's why other festivals are doing it online. The picture, of course, shows Bantayan Film Festival. They also, aside from this one-time, big-time screenings, you understand that in the province, you have like far-flung barangays, and they also visit those barangays to screen their films. For partnerships, what will be the cost of the partnership? Will it be media partnership? Are they co-organizing? Are they programming for you? Or it's just a sponsorship, or you just get their cash and that's it. But do you share the same values? This is the Kalampag Tracking Agency by Shirin Seno and Merv. I think they partnered with Cinematex because they want to screen it to other parts of the country as well. And some of their films are in 35 millimeter format, but unfortunately we can't have projectors of 35mm films nationwide. So selected lang. And they have to, I think for the partnership, they have to partner strategically and to check kung anong partners yung, that could cater to the request as well. So you should also consider that in organizing your mini festivals. For the platform or the venue, so where can the audience find you? Where are the events happening? So will it be in a bar? Will it be in a small theater? Will it be at a school hall or barangay hall? And the schedule, so when is it happening? So was it set up to have audience in mind? If you want school kids to watch your artwork or your films, was it scheduled na friendly sa kanila na pwede silang pumunta kahit na may pasok sila? Will it be screened sa school? So if you want to target the young audiences, pwede ba silang pumunta sa venue na yun at that specific time or not? So you must consider these things as well. So available platforms that you can explore during the pandemic to connect with the community is one, Vimeo. This is, I think, this is the most friendly, and I think it's my favorite platform then if I want to screen or program films. You can also, of course, put videos on YouTube or Facebook, and even your talkbacks like this one or seminars or conferences hosted sa Zoom can be screened there as well. So these are just a few platforms that you can explore or you can try using. So this is an example of a Vimeo showcase that we did for Lisbon. So this is Cine Filipina Lisbon for the Philippine Women's Month. So imagine if you have more videos there, it will be full of thumbnails then na may videos. If you also have more IT in your pool of resources or people who knows how to do websites, then you can just upload it on Vimeo and then link it na para dun lang siya ma-view sa website na yon. You can arrange it. But for starters or for those of you na wala naman budget to start and you just want to start, you can use Vimeo, YouTube, or Facebook. And you just have to strategically define when you're releasing it, up to what time, if you don't want to risk piracy sa film ninyo and for it to spread uncontrollably. Okay, so this one, I just took it out actually, making the presentation sa Canva, and they have this template, this cute template. And there's a slide, hindi ko na in-edit because it said that video is number one, or 80% of the internet traffic is video. I think because of the digital era then that most of the people are familiar with the medium. This is random na slide. I think it speaks a lot and it connects to the presentation rin. That's why you flood social media and YouTube even with cat videos, like cute cat videos, like videos that would make you feel good, like just watching baking, cleaning a house, etc. And daming random videos sa YouTube or social media, and the internet traffic is full of it. And that's why maybe Kwentong Jollibee also is a hit, and advertisers would spend more making videos and content and then release it online than TV, because it's been proven effective. And if you want to connect with your audience, as they say, if your audience can't come, you should go to where your audience is. If they are online right now, I think it's just right to go online as well and connect with them. So looking ahead, what can artists do during the pandemic? So this talk is just actually like reorienting or reviewing the basics. If you want to explore the medium, you should tap or connect with people na pwede nyong kausapin. Maybe you can talk to Joe R na I've heard ng video rin na nasa barko siya. To Sir Leo, who's done production designs of a lot of films rin. To Sir Manny, who's been exhibited rin yung digital art niya. You can start with your own collectives of collecting videos or just doing it by yourself first and ask a friend or someone to, you know, to share the idea, the concept with. Tapos yun nga, if you can just share it online and have like a mini talk back, you can do that. And you can always explore the possibility of organizing an art festival online. It would require you more time, maybe preparing if it's your first time, pero in the long run, when you're familiar with the medium and how it's done, madali na lang yan. Like before we wanted to do a festival, like 2-3 months talaga dapat, but sometimes when, alam nyo naman, sa ibang offices, di ba? Hindi appendicitis minsan yung drive, pero yung time nga and limited resources, so you have to make do with what you have, and sometimes a month would be enough. Sometimes it's it's more than enough. Depende rin sa scope ng project. Ayun. So I'd like to end with this bonfire kasi yun nga, similar to traditions natin of storytelling, because before, di ba, you gather around the bonfire, you tell your stories, you ask questions, napupumustahan. Film festival actually is a community gathering together and coming together. It's just you presenting your film, then you get reactions or you answer questions, etc. So it's like going around the bonfire. Pero ngayon nga, film lang yung medium natin. So yun, so I hope you won't be too afraid to go around the bonfire or to start your fire and to, you know, talk with everyone or with your collective. I hope, sorry if medyo mabilis, we don't have much time rin. And ayun, I hope imparted something for everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your insightful presentation, Drew. And perhaps you could also note how some artists also utilize video or moving images in their art exhibitions to complement the visual experience of the exhibition itself. Yeah, so we'd like to open the floor for questions from the audience. So if you have any questions, I think somebody raised their hand. If you would like, we can give you the floor to put the question in the chat box. And we have the island coordinator for ACLAN, Ms. Aileen Hernandez.
Hello, hello, Brian. Hello, Sir Drew. I guess I just have one question for Drew. With the situation we are having now with the pandemic, and you know, everyone is on lockdown, how do you stay relevant doing film festivals?
Okay, so that's a hard one. I think it's also our question for ourselves rin, because, you know, I'm working in FBCP and we wanted to, you know, help promote and develop filmmakers rin. And we have this yearly event called the Pisa ng Pelikulang Pilipino. And if, you know, even if other festivals actually can relate rin, maybe similar to Viva Expan as well, staying relevant means still having that impact, and you can't build impact or create impact if there's none or there's no audience. So maybe for films, it's trying to find balance of mitigating the risk of piracy of the content and also going to where your audiences are and making that, although we, let's admit that exhibitions or whatever, you can't really fully imitate the personal or live interaction and the actual event that's happening. You can't bring everything online. Iba pa rin yung feeling na nanonood kasi sinihan, sabay kayong tatawa or hahalakhak, sabay-sabay kayong nakikita niyo yung installation arts, etc. And just compare din anong nakikita ng isa, anong nakikita mo, ganyan. But to stay relevant maybe is to remain in touch with your audience and to still impart little by little. And then until hopefully someday we'll be fully alive without masks outside and then share different or new experiences then.
Okay. Thank you for that, Sir Drew.
Thank you, Drew. So,
yes, Brian, go.
Go, Ms. Aileen. Oh, okay. From our audience, from I think in YouTube and Facebook Live, somebody asks, or shall I put the two questions already, or shall I put the first question first? How does your work address the current social and political issues?
Work as a programmer, or okay, so maybe I'll just have it in that point of view. In film, similar to art, and similar to other mediums of art, I mean, you can be creative rin in addressing social issues. And some artists, unfortunately, would not want to touch those social issues. So personally, I'm part of an organization. It's called the KILA, and then the activist, the Human Rights Film Center, Human Rights Center. So we use the medium creatively to express other artists' expression or to give voice to the voiceless, and yun nga, to let other people be informed or to have more exposure of these kinds of art. So we do that. We create projects, and well, now mostly online, that could bridge the gap on education, on exposure, on know-how, on these issues, etc. But with my other work, in my day job as a project development officer in a government agency, in terms of issues, if it's like social political issues, we also support filmmakers and we fund filmmakers as well who do their projects. And during the pandemic, we created a platform for them to use. That's the project that I led then last year. It's the FDCP channel. So it's a platform where they could put their films and have maybe a practice of and have a feel of that industry side of film distribution. I hope I answered the question.
We would like to also acknowledge Sir Leo's question or comment in the chat box. Maybe it will be helpful to the audience to articulate the difference between moving image and film or cinema. Or is there such a distinction, or is the distinction necessary? Can you please?
Yeah, ako personally, Sir Leo, I think kasi nagbi-blur na nga of on the moving image, and others, especially curators and artists, would label their artwork sometimes if it's not really a manipulation of the medium, they call it video art, but in strict sense, it should just be a manipulation of the medium without any story. But sometimes as well, other programmers would label alternative art and their random films that they tell a story in their synopsis, but visually you can see it. I don't think there's a distinction that distinction is necessary. But personally, it's how you, in a festival or programmer's point of view, it's how you want your audience to perceive it as well. Yun nga, as I shared earlier, even cat videos are being programmed in the US and even in Europe, and they celebrate it. I mean, they celebrate people who document their cats or their experiences with their pets. It can be considered a film, or it can be considered not a film by others. So yun, it's very blurry. There's a gray area. And maybe for the audiences rin, if you're not comfortable of calling your output film in the strictest sense of a film with a Hollywood influence, and then what we know that there is like a narrative style or a story that needs to be told, then you just don't call it film. It's like other artists, not calling themselves artists, but creators. So parang yun lang siguro. I know it's not really a direct technical answer, but I hope I also answered that, because in others with the digital age, anything that's captured and, you know, put up, exhibited or whatever, it's like a moving image, it's like video art, even pixelations, it's also video art. So yun.
So Ms. Aileen, do you have a question? So if there's another, I could ask one last question from our audience, from our social media platforms. Hola na, Ms. Aileen.
Okay, so...
Yes, so the last question would be, what's your starting point? Wait, sorry. Yes, Ms. Aileen, go, please.
There's a delay, sorry. Nothing, Brian. You can go ahead.
Okay, so what's your starting point in creating concepts for a film?
Well, for a film, okay. So I'm not a film expert, but if I create a film, it depends rin on the kind of film that you're doing. If you're doing a narrative, then maybe you can start with a story. Sometimes artists would, depende rin sa artist, eh, if a story would drive them, or artists would also, like the treatment would drive them, that they want to exhibit this area, but they want like falling objects, etc. Then they create a story out of it. But others also would start with a story, like, okay, I want to feature this tendera in our town. And then you start to think how you make that film, or on an opening shot mo, how will you present the tendera? So depende rin. Pero ako personally, I'd like to start always with the story, and then the technicals and whatever, like the cinematography, the shot, etc., it would follow. If it's curation or programming, I would start with a concept or with a context. Kung ano ba, bakit ko to gagawin. and then I create that one theme or context, and then I proceed on getting other artworks or checking if there are artworks that would fit the possible curation. But sometimes there's also programs or projects where you are presented with artworks already or films already, then you just have to make do with what they have and just find something common in them and then have a concept or a context and write about it. So parang ganun. It depends on the situation, pero yun, if film siya, then ako personally, stories, I start with stories in the narrative.
So thank you, Sir Drew, for your presentation and for asking some of our questions. That ends our Panay Possibilities webinar.
Thank you
so much. You.
Hello, Brian.
I'd like to...
I think there is a follow-up question from Professor
Ricona. Yes.
So she's asking, we should also recognize the potential of video festival, or it's a statement, I guess.
Yeah.
We should also recognize the potential of video festivals to accommodate various art forms in their program, creating more intermedial festivals.
Yeah, I agree. Hello, Dayang. I miss you. I don't know if you still have the same number. Anyway, so yon. Yes, because actually in a strict, it's a project. It's like a community gathering together. You can just put any art form there. Like some festivals, like for example, in Malaya, they'll have like a visual arts exhibit. They also have like exhibit of the things, of their props na ginamit sa pelikula. So it's an intermedia festival. I've been to a festival where we have to bring like a Filipino artist to perform because they have like a music concert during the festival. Meron rin silang culinary art on the side because meron yung, it was in Mexico. So meron silang, we have one night that we watch a film, tapos we proceed to this restaurant, and then there's like a fusion of the Filipino and Mexican cuisine, and tapos they present it because culinary is also an art. Like, okay, so this is like a fusion of sisig in sisig tacos, parang ganyan. So this is like the Mexico and this is like the Philippine, etc. So yes, it can be an intermedia festival with music, with culinary, with video art, visual arts, etc. And you can do so much more actually if you have like more resources, more artists. And I think that's just not be afraid of the different types of art that you do, because yun nga, there's always a place for you. Yun nga, ang funny ng cat videos, and kahit yung drone na napanood ko one time, na parang nung pinapanood ko siya, parang ako parang bakit ganito, bakit ito yung nasa screen lang, like ganun lang yung drone. But then they tell the story, it's actually a survey of the place, like it's from the sea, tapos it goes to the rivers, and then they show you the farms, etc., and that water is polluted already by these factories before it goes to the villages. So parang anlalim siya pala. And then, so it's just a way of presenting it. And I think it's a unique medium rin. Ayun, so thank you so much, Dayang rin and Manny. I hope I do justice to the Vivo artists who are present. And yes, let's collaborate soon.
Okay, so that's...
Yes, and then Sir Leo also, thinking at the statement. Art forms are interrelated and not only discrete creative. Yes, I agree, sir. Because yun nga, there's also there are films as well. Now, because of the production design or how you create the set, it gives more meaning to the film. And there are also some films na because of their music, it gives another story or elicit more emotion. So yun, I'm talking a lot. Thank you so much, everyone. I think we still have an next part of the program, so we go there.
So. That's a very good conclusion, Joe. So if there are no more other questions, we'd like to thank Drew for sharing with us his expertise. And that concludes Panay Possibilities in behalf of all the Panay coordinators. I now give the virtual floor to Manny. Sir Manny, the floor is yours.
Hi. Thank you for giving me the floor. I hope you give me the roof in the future when rainy season comes. So thank you very much for our guest speakers, our artists, Leo Abaya, Joar, and Andrew, our speaker, and our hosts, moderators Eileen, Brian, and Patrick Flores, Sheila, and Marika. And to our audience, thank you very much. I would like to invite everyone for our next series of talks on May, focusing on a seminar node of Kalibutan, featuring Region 7 with Maria Taniguchi and Jay Hore, and with artists Mona Alcudia, Solitario Cinco, Gabby Nazareno, and retired artists. On May 22, we have Lockdown Art. We have invited Mark Salvatus. And then on May 29, we have an island special featuring Visayan art initiatives here in Negros Occidental. So thank you very much for attending today's session. We are almost, we are 2 months, no? 2 months till we unfold Kalibutan, the world in mind. So I'm quite excited. I think everybody is excited, and it's quite interesting to know and to learn from the processes of our artists. No, it's really inspiring. No, to see different points of view of their practice. No, and discovering new things also as they do their work. So thank you very much. Have a pleasant weekend and stay safe. Thank you very much. Maraming salamat.